We welcome Stuart Simpson. He is the CEO of Vertical Aerospace, that being an eVTOL business. But it's not just EV anymore, it's going hybrid. And we're here to discuss with you, Stuart, how you're announcing, I think it's a 1,000-mile hybrid electric VTOL. So this is all about vertical takeoff and landing, but now with a much longer range.
That's absolutely correct, and thank you for that. That really captures what we're doing brilliantly. Our background was as an electric aircraft, but we always knew this was coming. So we're not jumping on a bandwagon. We designed from the start to have the largest airframe in this sector. More people, more things. Perfect for defence.
OK. It feels as though initially we captured you as someone who wanted to do quick hop-on, hop-off passenger rides. But then why make this transition into defence? What had you hit in terms of milestones to be able to decide that now was the time to add on the hybrid offering?
So we've been working on our hybrid for over 18 months. So this is something when the board felt comfortable, we can do it, we announced it. So we always knew it was in the long-term plan, larger airframe, but we've proved the hybrid on the bench. We'll have the whole aircraft flying with a hybrid powertrain next summer. Incredibly exciting.
When it comes to flying, what you need is sign off and regulation and certification. Some might say, look, this movement into the defense space often allows certification to become maybe a little clearer. Is that tends to be why we see companies such as yours try to offer into the space?
So for us, as I say, always on the roadmap for us, we've got a very clear 2028 certification date for our all-electric vehicle. This is a slightly different path, may accelerate things a little bit, which is great for us and our shareholders. But it's all additive to the base case, the kill electric aircraft.
So what applications will you find in defence for a hybrid such as yours?
I think all. I mean, people, things, it's all about that, and it's stealthy. So the huge range, the huge payload, and low noise signature, low heat signature means this is open to all sorts of applications in the defence space.
Let's talk about where you're from, because you've jetted in from the United Kingdom, and really you're one of the last European eVTOL and now hybrid offerings standing in Europe more broadly. Why is that the case, and do you need to come over to the United States for customer base at least?
So we have amazing customers all around the world, including American Airlines in the US, so great to partner with them. Being based in Europe means we certify under the CAA and EASA, which is a very clear standard. You can double-click on it, download the work stack, and we know we can certify in 2028. Very clear process.
Well, it's as clear as the FAA? Because often we find that those regulators actually take their lead from here.
Yeah, actually, it's much clearer. In 2016, EASA wrote a very specific piece of legislation called SC-VTOL, Special Condition VTOL, and that tells you how to certify the aircraft. Being very precise, 10 to the minus 9, 1 in a billion, same as a large passenger jet, which is what we think customers need and deserve. So there is no transition in safety when you get off a large passenger jet across the Atlantic, jump on one of our aircraft and fly downtown into New York.
So you talk about the customer base that's already here in the US from a civil aviation perspective,
yes.
But what about from a defense perspective? Who do you hope to be selling into?
So we can't really talk about that. We've had deep discussions for a long time with many potential customers, particularly in Europe, because that's where we're based. And given the geopolitical environment at the minute, it's a really unique selling point. We are the only player in Europe. So that gives us a prime position there to capture that market. We'd, of course, love to sell into the US as well. Just signed a $1 billion deal with Honeywell last week, so it positions us brilliantly.
And that's from a supply chain perspective. Talk us through the Honeywell agreement and what's ultimately being brought to bear with that particular partnership.
Yeah, I mean, at Honeywell, we've worked with them for 6 years, so they're deeply embedded, our team and the Honeywell team. And we've signed up with them to provide basically the whole cockpit of the aircraft, the way the pilot interfaces with the aircraft and tells it what to do, and the whole flight control system underneath it. So it's fully integrated. And a huge bonus, you can bolt on autonomy really simply. So it positions us brilliantly. Really exciting day last week.
Okay, so when you're intertwining your own technology and that of Honeywell's, how seamlessly does that have to work? What sort of technological breakthroughs are you having to make at the moment?
Actually, after 6 years, we've made the breakthroughs. We've signed the production and certification contract with them. So we are locked in with them. We're locked in with another couple of suppliers for production and cert. And we'll have more announcements over the coming weeks and months on that.
So you really feel that by come 2028, we will have your electric offering in the skies as well as the hybrid one?
Absolutely.
And absolutely. What's the cost that takes you there? Have you got that all planned out? I know that you've been putting out your money, well, the statements of how you currently are seeing net operating cash flow outflows. Do you need to raise more to get to that 2028 level?
Yeah, absolutely. We cleaned up our balance sheet in December, and just to bring that to life, I couldn't go to any conferences. I did one investor conference last year because our balance sheet was not investable. We cleared that out the 23rd of December, raised $90 million in a couple of weeks, and when I did that, it was clear we'd raise money again this year.
And what sort of strategic investors or indeed venture investors are you looking for?
So we're looking at all the different verticals, and I think if I take a step back, what myself, the chairman, and majority shareholder, Jason, the biggest thing for us over the next couple of years would be to land a strategic investor. Not because we necessarily need one, but it's such a vote of confidence in the future of the business.
And we have seen partnerships. Joby, for example, is working closely with airlines, with Uber. How are you seeing the competitive landscape evolve, particularly here in the United States?
Well, we've got the best aircraft. We are the only one in the world at the safety standard we're doing. We are the only one. So that gives us a unique position. We've got the biggest cabin. I've sat in the others. We're a little bit smaller. Ours is big. We have four executive class seats. You can expand it to six. You can take luggage. We have the best aircraft. So, yeah, really excited about bringing it to market. It's only a few short years now.
And when you say that you've got the best safety standards, who is the judge of that thus far if we're still awaiting CAA approval, FAA approval?
It's the regulator. The CAA and EASA have defined these aircraft to be the same as large passenger jets, the same level of safety. Because this is mass transport. The goal is to have thousands of these flying. So you really want to have the highest level of safety. And that is, definitively, 10 to the minus 9. The FAA is at a slightly lower level.
OK, so you've ticked that box. What next in terms of how you continue along the milestones that you've currently set yourself?
We'll be doing some incredible flight testing later this quarter.
And that's already signed off and in the plan?
If we were based in America, we'd be doing it already. But there's a joint liability in the UK between the regulator and the company. So to fly in public airspace, which we'll be doing, they need to sign that off. So it's a major, major step when we do that later this quarter.